This moment is for us to truly have an interaction about jiu-jitsu, right? I think what makes everybody connect here is that we all train jiu-jitsu. Most of us, at least some family members that probably don't do it, but they are involved in the jiu-jitsu environment. And we can share our experience to be able to inspire, guide, and maybe some of us over here might not be early students anymore, but we already run our own schools, and we are professors and leaders, and also can help us to understand the mindset of how a student's journey begins and how we overcome the challenges of developing ourselves in jiu-jitsu, right? So if you think about how it is to be a white belt again, I'm sure maybe there's some white belts over here can have this feeling really fresh. But for some of us that have been training for a little while, it's really hard sometimes to have that feeling to what it is to be a white belt. But to be able to begin, open up the discussion, the thought is for those higher grades, what would you tell yourself when you just about, if you just started jiu-jitsu again? If you could go back in time, what would you tell yourself as a white belt? So this will be a question where we can elaborate a little bit. So maybe who over here has got an interesting point about your experience as a white belt, and what would you be able to go back there and tell yourself, you know, so you could have shortcut some improvements and you would make yourself maybe a better black belt today or a better purple belt, whatever grade that you are. Maybe Braulio.
Me? Ladies and gentlemen. it's a very broad question, very, very good question. Oh, Flav is there as well, for you that he's coming here.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of things I would like to tell myself when I was a blue belt, a white belt back in the day, for sure. One of it would be to try to understand the whys of things instead of just copy others or trying to be better than others, you know? That's what I would tell myself. And then when it comes down to this point, I actually was talking to this subject 2 weeks ago in Jersey, with Professor Rob, you know, it led this advice to myself. It leads to the main message of high expectations. I remember that when I started training, and we are all white belts. There was one blue belt, and the coach that was a brown belt. You know, within 10 months. 8 months in jiu-jitsu, there was a lot of competition. Who is going to get blue belt quicker than others, blah, blah, blah. And I happened to feel that I was on the right to get the blue belt. I had 3 stripes on my white belt. And I was like, seminar Friday night. Hey, perfect. It's my turn now. Come on. I'm better than this. This is on my mind. I'm better than this. I'm better than this. But this is my time. I'm going to be a blue belt. So I even bought my own blue belt. I put in a bag, brought to the training, left there. I don't even remember what the workshop was about. I don't even remember nothing, because all I was thinking about was getting that blue belt that I was so certain, right? When I got there, seminar passes, ends it, and I go. Maybe the coach didn't see me. So I passed by him a couple of times. I passed like a coach. He didn't acknowledge. I go, damn, come on, man. I go, coach. And he goes, what's up, bro? I see you on Monday. I said, God damn it, he noticed me. And I still didn't get the blue belt, right? And that was a very big lesson I remember. because since I started training jiu-jitsu, up until that time, I trained every single day, you know, sometimes even twice a day, apart from Sundays, of course. But I never miss a class. If not, I would add another one. When, you know, seminar finished, the workshop finished, I went home, and I was walking home, you know, I was really, really upset, you know, head down, walking back with my blue belt on the bag. Get home, you know, my mom always has some things for me, ready for cooking, you know, for us, right, Victor? Then I just went straight to the shower, and put the shower on the loudest possible. I threw my blue belt on the way, my gi the other way. I said, that's it, I'm not doing this anymore. Forget about this. What the heck? How come I'm not a blue belt? Is he blind? Look what I did this, what I did that, what I did this. It's my time. Why I don't deserve that? And then I said, you know what? I'm not training anymore. Forget about this. 8 months. I'm not training anymore. Forget it. I don't want to do this. I don't want to, you know, come on. Of course I'm a blue belt. Past one day, just like nothing happened. Second day, I start getting a little the itch, like, you know, never stop training, never not training more than 2 days by then. And then the third day, I go, man, I gotta train. But hey, yo, I need to have a chat with myself because I didn't really want to feel what I felt 3 days ago, you know, because I really feel really bad. I feel really disappointed with myself and with the situation, you know, and I got sad and I don't like to feel that way. But at the same time, I wanted to go back. So I remember going to the mirror, not talking loud, but talking to myself and look at me and say, listen, you want to go back and train, huh? But look what happened, that drama that you just made 2 days ago. So you want to go train. So that's cool, go back train. But if you decide to go back and train, you don't gonna be putting high expectations to the point that's gonna make you feel that way. You know, and I made up my mind. And I said, okay, from now on, I'll go train, but not to be better than that guy, or that guy. Not to beat that guy, or that guy, but try to be as good as it could have been. And that was a huge change on my mindset. And that was my first ever lesson for high expectations. Because expectations are good and are necessary for you to push yourself. But when you put too high, when you want to expect something too much, nothing is 100%. You know, so this lesson made me understand that if I can be my full potential, you know, you got as good as you could ever be. It is a positive. If that full potential will make you a world champion or not, it doesn't matter. Because if you reach your full potential, whatever you're going to feel is exactly how a world champion feels. Because you beat as far as you could go. And that was the biggest lesson that I had on the white belt, and I carried on, blinked my eyes. This year, 5th degree. Whoop, whoop. Thank you. I thought you would say thank you for the message. You just wanted the microphone.
God damn it.
I already thank you way too many times. It's amazing, you know, like this mentality that you just described, you know, it is something that everybody who wants truly develop into something consistently needs to really implement, because otherwise it's not sustainable. You know, if you have the level of expectations, it just leads to quitting feelings. That can be about a belt, but that can also be about anything that we have in our lives, you know, like maybe how people treat you. You do something kind, something lovely, but you don't get the same thing back. There's also an expectation that we have that sometimes not necessarily for the right reasons, right? If you truly want to do something good for someone, you don't do it to expect something back from that person, but because it's the right thing to do. But if you have that expectation on people, that means you're doing it for the wrong reasons. So truly do be kind and lovely because you feel it's the right thing to do, no matter what it is other people do. It's nice when you have kindness back, but maybe the expectation how the kindness comes, not necessarily comes directly from the person, but from others. And I think we can connect a lot with being a teacher in jiu-jitsu, right? Sometimes many of us here are in positions of leadership in our own schools. We are giving our hearts and souls to our students. You know, as a professor, you do this a lot, and you do this sometimes to many. And I think sometimes the students don't appreciate how much we care for each one of them, because they are only one. We are only one to them, but there are many to us. Some people may feel they are unnoticed, but in our eyes, each one of the students that we have in our mats are critical for the development and the reassurance that everything is going to continue no matter what. So many professors, I'm sure, have felt heartbroken when perhaps a student leaves, right? I think that links expectation to that feeling, right? And I think that once I understood that as a jiu-jitsu professor, as a leader in my school, I needed to do the best service of jiu-jitsu that I can possibly give in order to make sure that all students in my school can feel they're getting a great service and value for being there. And whether they stay or not is not in my control, but I wash my hands to do the best I can.
And if, focus on your key control.
Exactly. So this is something that I relate a lot, you know, not just in the, as a white belt, but you can also bring the same topic
to
relate to life and also to leadership and more advanced positions. So what this is about relationship. So whenever that is a relationship, that is something that we'll give. Because we are constantly exchanging, correct? We're exchanging with people all the time. Friendship, we will do something kind. You can't expect somebody to be cordial back to you. And it's a human thing to kind of feel that interaction. But once we do things for the right reasons, we are detached from the negativity, the negative feelings that you may have when that return doesn't happen. I think that makes us free. Free to be ourselves, free to be great professionals without the worries about the negativity that may come on our way when things doesn't work out. And it goes back to the drawing board, right? We are going to just keep going anyways.
Exactly.
Because it's the best you can, and that's all you can control.
Focus on what you can control, and then the results.
That's it. That's it. And then,
so that applies like when the student goes to compete. I try to pass also to my students, for example, like for them, don't focus like on the results, you know, just focus on what they can do, like to go out there and do the best they can do, you know. Like whatever they're doing on their training, on their preparation, that's what they're gonna apply like in the tournament, but not to worry about if they're gonna win or lose, because that we cannot control, you know. And then when you already put that pressure on yourself, you know, like to win, and you ended up like not performing very good, you know. So I try to tell them like just to do your best, like have fun. That's what matters. That's what you can do. The results, the victory is like a consequence. If you're working hard, if you're doing everything that you're supposed to do, the most likely, a good result will come from it. But sometimes you can be training super hard, you're doing everything like the best you can do, but sometimes you don't accomplish what you were expecting, you know? So if you put too much expectations, you ended up like getting frustrated.
Yeah, 100%.
I think related like to expectations.
Yeah, it brings back to the competition expectation.
Mm-hmm.
I think one of the things that we can also connect with this expectation topic is, maybe I get the microphone back. About the expectation topic is that sometimes, I'm sure some of you guys have been in that position, or maybe not. Maybe you've seen people going through that. Maybe imagine this. You go to the school. Maybe you're already a fit, strong person. You feel like you're already talented, or you already have a background from different martial arts. And you go to a new environment of learning jiu-jitsu for the first time. And perhaps you went to that environment building that expectation of yourself that actually reversed. You feel like you're super capable, you're going to do a great job. Now we throw the coin on the other side. And hey, I feel like I'm gonna get this guy. He looks skinny and slim. And I'm feeling, I'm 88, I'm strong. And I'm gonna go there, and I'm gonna take care of this smaller, younger person. And suddenly, jiu-jitsu has the talent, the ability to show you the other side of the coin very fast. How about that? Have you noticed someone going through that? Have you been in that position that you underestimated this scenario, and then got proven very, very, very wrong very quickly? anybody could share. I know a story about Stuart. He's not even here today, but that's that would be a funny thing to start with him. But
let's go. Is it on?
Yeah.
All right, guys. For anyone who doesn't know me, my name is Professor Graeme Finneran, first degree black belt under Professor Braulio, Professor Victor, and I'm an alcoholic. Thank you for letting me share. No, seriously, guys, going back to what Professor Vic was saying originally, you know, if you had a message as a white belt, what you would tell yourself. I started jiu-jitsu quite late, really, you know, 2023, which is, you know, late for the development of jiu-jitsu to be world champion and stuff like that. And at the time when I started jiu-jitsu, I was in a parachute regiment, and I was in a very sort of like an elite force with inside of the parachute regiment, and was extremely fit, extremely strong soldier, and they used to call me the man machine. And I used to be able to run everyone into the ground, drive everyone into the ground, and my fitness was extremely strong. It's always been the asset that I've always had,
back
and
the
strength
the day,
yeah. And back in the day, not anymore. And I remember, like, when I started jiu-jitsu, I always felt like I was fighting the person in front of me. Like I was battling, right? It's me against Braulio now. It's me against Victor now. It's me against Rob here. It's me against you. And I used to treat it like it was kind of like a little bit ego, you know, like ego. I couldn't get beat by these people. And you did, you know, and it was tough to handle. And I always felt like I was in a fight with these people. And I always thought that, you know, I've got to beat every white belt in the room now. Now I've got to beat every blue belt when I was a blue belt. Now I've got to beat every purple belt, you know, and so on, so on, so on. And only recently I realized, now I've got my own school and I teach a lot of students, like a lot of students. And recently I got injured and I had to have two surgeries. I couldn't train for almost 13 months. And I realized only like recently, that is not like what jiu-jitsu is. Like, if I could tell myself a message back then, it was like, it's just me against me. It's just me against me. And if that guy beats me, that's just me against me again. It's the guy in the mirror. Every day it's the guy in the mirror. And I only realized that recently because now I'm coming back to training. My fitness is nowhere near where it needs to be. The strength is nowhere near it needs to be. The mind is telling my body to do something and the body's not doing it. And it's quite hard to come to terms with. But you've got to remember, again, I have to tell myself every day, I'm not against Braulio, I'm not against Victor. That's just a version of myself against that person. And if I make a mistake and I get caught, then that was my mistake. That was me against me. I made the mistake and they capitalized and that's the way it is. And for so many years, I thought I was in this battle, but now I realize it's just you against you. You know what I mean? So when you're training, now as a white belt, blue belt, purple belt, or wherever, it doesn't matter about the belt in front of you. It doesn't matter about the person in front of you. It's you against you. How you treat that person, how you apply your game, that is you. When you touch hands with someone and you start to train, your personality comes out. You know, if you're assertive, if you're aggressive, if you're selfish, you know, your personality comes out. That's you. So if I could pass on a message, you know, as you go up the grades, you know, you need to remember that everyone's on their own journey. Everyone's on their own path. Everyone's in their own age division, weight division. You know, everyone's super talented or takes longer to develop. You know what I mean? And as a professor now, I only realize that now, recently, that it's just me against me. And I have to tell myself that every single day when I turn up to the gym and I've got a young 18-year-old, super, you know, super heavyweight, lean, Gracie Barra ambassador who wants to rip my head off every single training session because he wants to be the best version of himself. So he wants to challenge against me. And then it's not me against him. That guy's now on his way to be world champion. That's great. I helped them develop to do that. And then it's not me against him. It's just me against me. And I have to remember that every single day when I go to training, especially now, you know, when the fitness and the strength is so good. So when you're training, you know, don't forget the ego. Leave the ego at the door. We always say it. It's always up on the door when we're walking through the door. But you know, the testosterone gets the better of us, and we want to be able to beat everyone in the room. And sometimes the ego follows us in. So just leave it at the door, you know. And then every time you come training, you are just challenging you. You're not challenging anyone in front of you. You know, they're just a reference for you to better yourself. You know, so if, you know, that's amazing. You know, that's how I feel about the situation.
It's pretty incredible. Thank you, Professor. Thank you. So
it's really, really nice to hear, you know, from your voice how much this means, because it shows that you broke through a major chapter in your development. And that shows really much that we are going through different breakthroughs in different times and in different situations in our lives. We all begin in different parts, right? You were super fit and strong for a long time, and then I wasn't. You know, jiu-jitsu helped me bring that elements to myself. And some people are automatically very confident as an individual, but sometimes others are not, and they need to work those elements. So in the kids program, you can see that's so easy, right? It's so nice to see the kids where you need to add value to them. But we are just those kids. We worked in different elements of those points with different efforts. And I think that when you meet those things, you have the confidence, the strength, but you also control the ego. That is when magic really happens, isn't it? Because when we were discussing about the first question, where perhaps, you know, we thought that we were really good, strong, but jiu-jitsu has a way to break you and to show you that maybe it's humbling, right? And this is nice to see that it was your humbling, your injury and your surgeries was your catalyst, you know, to find the humbleness in a very specific form, but that's what it is, right? And that's amazing. I think I had stories from Stuart Wild when first met Braulio and met me. He had this image, Stuart Quiltz is Gracie Barra, Housonian professor, a good friend of ours for many years. He always made this massive joke, and every time we were around, about how it is to train with Braulio for the first time. When he went to traditional jiu-jitsu school, he was doing really well against everybody. He could tap the professor and everything else. And then suddenly he thought he would be able to do the same with Braulio. And Braulio was already a world-class competitor. So it kind of, it didn't really...
It wasn't very good.
It was not very good for him, but it really shows that, you know, when your expectations are measured sometimes by contrast. When you are in different environments, let's say you're in a comfortable environment, things are easy to measure. You can see.
Yeah, but he's talking about, like, I was a professor, I was teaching. And then I broke him a little bit more than what he expected. But what really broke Stuart was when I put my younger brother to train with him. He was only 17, 18 years old. A purple belt. And that was a problem.
It was...
Oh my God, that little kid with the hair like that big. I said, what hair? Okay, I didn't get the hair, but I got.
What are you talking about?
Kid, and he got to him. Hey, he thought more to Victor than to me.
Well, on my defense, which I can link to another part of the development of an individual, which is linked to ego, it's a kind of interesting thing. I arrived in the UK, I was 19 years old, and automatically I was put in a position where I needed to be a teacher, but I never taught before. I never had a mentor that could guide me and support me and show me how it's done. I basically, here we go, I don't even speak English, now go teach. But I never taught jiu-jitsu in Portuguese or in English. How do I do this? So automatically I put the respect of the individual on the grade. That was me. I measure the standard based on the grade. So I felt, I am a purple belt and I'm a 19 years old.
I need to behave like
me. I couldn't have the respect that a belt will give you, and I didn't have the maturity of an experienced practitioner to be able to sustain my worth on the mats based on my abilities or experience. I actually base all of that on my ability to tap people out. And that's actually a very interesting topic because I came from an environment where Otavio and Braulio, the same environment, that we basically, by the way, for those who doesn't know, we were training together since childhood. So we are like lifelong friends. He lived in the same street pretty much as I lived, and we are all connected for many years.
He lived in our house for how many years?
And then
10 months.
Yeah, Otavio came over to the UK like in 2008, spent time with us. So we basically had this history. But jiu-jitsu at that time was not developed. Mentorship was not something available so easily. Like now we know we can connect with our leaders inside the organization so much easier. We can be inspired by others who have done the same as us for many years, like Marcia Carlos, is able to influence us much more today with our communications, with, you know, with internet and be able to travel and truly in person. So we have mentorship now, but we didn't have them. And I felt like this is one of the things I had to truly evolve as an instructor, as a professor eventually, which was a different way to gain my respect. And then it was a very conflicted way of valuing myself because I valued the implementation of jiu-jitsu as the most important moral value on the mats. I was guided by an egotistic mindset. You are only worth as much as you beat everybody. And if you don't beat everybody, you are no longer worth the same. So then I felt myself in an unsustainable mindset because my peak will happen. Eventually my peak will go down. And then what is my true worth? But at that time, I never had anybody coaching me to tell me those things. I had to live that. I lived that. I had mentors that really helped me see this. So that was my true response, for real. I thought that I needed to tap everybody. David is here. Where is David? Right there. He remembered the times that even built a reputation around me at that time that I used to tap everybody out multiple times. All the time. I never had a measure, you know. I did this to like, it was 08, 07, no, actually 05, 06. Imagine this. It's like a long time ago. And the classes in Acox Green, in the beginning of Gracie Barra Birmingham, it was, everybody who trained was only like, that could handle that. And because that's all we knew. It was not for everyone. And then I think our ability to grow and develop, it was happening on the go, right? And so funny to talk about mentorship, and I could link with another question that I can raise to some of the people here. And who was, because in order for us to see through things and guide ourselves on a process of inexperience, we have so much information in the world, information of techniques, information of about everything, right? Techniques and how to be and viewpoints crossing over from right, left, and center. Everybody thinks different and it's so hard to guide through a good path that has a global understanding. Because I feel like nowadays with social media and YouTube and everything, everybody's somehow become specialist. And they're specialists based with no experience or no global view. They are based on a very short period of time doing that thing. But we all understand it takes much longer than a few years of that to truly embrace. So in my opinion, in order to grow and develop with a global view, you need to have great mentorship. So you need to have mentors. And anybody here, you know, for me, Marcia Carlos was a major one. Maybe that's a question for Flavio. Flavio, you know, who was someone who truly represented this mentorship to guide you through this journey of global development? Not global, I mean, in the world, but global, like, as a whole, right? Not just a period of it.
Well, man, I think we all have that same reference, right? Master Carlos was a father figure to so many of us. And I think for a lot of people here today that there's something unique about that all of us have been through, you know, growing up in Brazil. It's the third world, and most of us who grew up in the 80s, in the 90s, which was a period of the country. It was one of the worst, economic situations the country has been through. And very well, you don't have to look too far out. You just got to look within your own family to know what struggles create to families. You know, families break apart. And most of us, we come from, you know, broken families. And when we come from broken families, especially when you're young, men and women, you need a reference. And Master Carlos played that father figure for so many of us in different stages of our lives in terms of giving us a north that we could develop towards. I'm trying to pinpoint something interesting for you guys because we talk about him so often. And I think that stories tell more than any theory that I could lay down here for you guys. But I think one of the greatest things that he does for people is that he sees the good in you more so than you're able to see in yourself. And I think that's a great thing that all of us can implement in our lives. I'm a dad of two daughters, and it's definitely a law that I, to the best of my abilities, I try to abide to, is to seeing them more good and more greatness than they can see themselves. So there was this kid, he was 14 years old. I think you're gonna remember this kid. That was before the Recife crew started to attend Rio de Janeiro because that was a game changer. That's the Recife crew, right? But at some point, Jiu-Jitsu was mostly a sport in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. So there was this kid, he was in trouble. And Master Carlos had this thing, he attracted great people. He attracted a lot of special people. And many of these special people that felt like attracted to him, they were really special. So this kid was a troubled kid, and his mom tried everything. Yep. So the mom tried psychiatrist, soccer, surfing, whatever that she could try. Nothing seemed to work, so somebody eventually gave this mom an advice. Hey, maybe you should bring this kid to martial arts. Fair enough, that's what most parents are struggling with their kids, including my own father, do with their troubled kids. And then eventually this kid comes to Gracie Barra, and Master Carlos talks to the mom, and the mom says, well, you know, he's a great kid. He's got a lot of energy, but he's troubled. He's like, well, I'm used to a lot of like troubled kids. Just look behind me, right? There's a lot of troubled kids here. And it's like, I think martial arts can help, discipline, respect, all of that good stuff. But he said, like, you don't understand, like, he's really troubled. And then Master Carlos eventually is like, all right, what has he done? He's like, he put the whole house on fire. They're like, what? Like for real, he put the house on fire. So I'm trying to see something that can help him. You know, like, and he's a good kid. He just needs directions. Like, okay, we can do that here. We'll keep an eye on him. And then the mom had one piece of advice. Just call him by his name. Just don't give him any nicknames. He's really attached to his name. Do you know what his name was? I don't, because I never knew his name. It took like about 2 days for the entire team to give him a nickname. Remember, he put his house on fire. So what's the best nickname you could give to someone who puts his house on fire? Most of you guys are Europeans here, so Nero sounds like a great nickname for a kid like that. Like Nero, if you don't know, is a Roman emperor that put Rome on fire, right? So that was the nickname, remember Nero? Yeah. So Nero became like this kid that was trouble and he was there. And the point here is that Master Carlos really thought he had something great in him. And even though the mom didn't believe in the kid, he did. The kid didn't believe in himself. And the kid started training with us. He was a little different, but he was actually a pretty nice kid. So eventually something great came out of this kid. He invented a jiu-jitsu technique. You know, too bad YouTube wasn't around in those days, but that would be like an amazing one.
I can demonstrate.
You can?
Yes.
Go ahead.
It's called Nó de Porco.
Nó de Porco.
It's called the pig nut.
Hi, Sebastian.
I have a upper part of a geese.
No? Do you have any geese? You can do with a collar, man.
Okay, I will save your shirt. But we start from the knees. So Nero would, you would put the hand here. What is not the threat, you know? Yeah? So from here, he would look to the side and he would jump like this. And from here, he'd pull back. He should make a lot of black belts, actually.
So that's the thing.
Because he was here and he kind of...
What's called the movie?
The Not Your Pork, the Pig Knot.
Then people start to call the Pig Knot. And his training used to look like this. He started training. Hello, Sebastian, okay? If he tried, he failed. Oh, pardon.
No more.
And then we were all like... That's it. No, that was his only thing. So if you didn't
only
work,
that work,
no, then finish. It was like this. Sorry to interrupt.
So, my professor Maia is being nice because he will jump on your neck with his both legs in your neck, and he will yank it, try to rip your head off. So it became a thing, and it became like a famous thing within the school. It's like, imagine, guys, you walk into a jiu-jitsu school, and there's a kid named Nero who put his house on fire and has a technique called the pig knot. And he jumps in your neck and he tries to rip your head apart.
So that a new black belt come to visit. We say, please, could you, you know? And the guy, okay, blue belt, it's a blue belt. And, yeah.
But, okay. So this thing became a thing within the school, and then eventually all of us, we were afraid of training with Nero, okay? And there was some senior guys, it was this purple belt, he was a tough guy, and he was a tough competitor back then, but he was traveling. And then just like Professor Maia said, he came back in town. And then, of course, like we all like very nice to each other, like, man, there's this new kid called Nero. Oh, Nero, why? Well, he put his house on fire. Oh, interesting. Yeah, he's really tough, but he's a white belt. He's like a purple belt, like very good. It's like, you should train with him. Yeah, but nobody told him he had the pig knot. Man, everybody did the whole gym stuff. It was like this circle here. And then Master Carlos goes, hey! Nero, hey! Go! Just like Maia demonstrated. Boom! And this guy is like, falls asleep.
Oh, no.
He falls asleep. I'm like, oh my God, leg up. The guy wakes up. Man, the moment he wakes up, he goes like this. Porrada, meu irmão. It's fight now. And then Master Carlos, oh, man, let the kid be. He did a good job. He choked you. Now accept. Anyways, it's a funny character. Porrada. One of the many within Gracie Barra. But I think what... the message here is that Master Carlos was really, really good at spotting the greatness in everybody. And the moral of that, the result of that story is that eventually Nero left the school. He went to do other things. But years later, the mom came back to the school and wanted to thank Master Carlos because the pig knot became a thing for him. Because it was the first thing that he's done in his life that he felt proud of, you know, and it was something that... that environment, that culture, that despite us making fun of each other, really nurtured something great. And because he felt like people believed in him, eventually he had an opportunity to do something great and carry on with his life. And that had a huge impact on him, you know? Maybe many of us don't have pig knots to brag about, but maybe there's something we learn on the mats, you know? That changes something about us, that then we can go out to the world with a little bit more confidence. So we can get out there and really do great things for our own life and for the lives that we have a chance to impact. So back to the question, Vitor. Yeah, the biggest influence I have is, of course, Carlos Gracie Jr. And if I could boil down everything that I've observed many years studying with him, is his faith in people, you know? And I had a chance to experience that myself. In terms of trying to become a
world champion at some point. And then later on, it was about becoming a good professor, later on a good school owner, later on other different roles within Gracie Barra. But he's taught me a lot of things, but perhaps the greatest thing he's taught me is just that I should believe in myself, because there was something great about me that I couldn't see, that he saw, and it certainly helped bring it out through the faith that he had in me. So that'll be it.
Amazing.
Yeah. I know he went to college, and I know he graduated.
Did you get black belt?
No, unfortunately not. But I'm sure he's still around and he's still probably doing great things, yeah.
Big knot. big knot. Yeah, this is it's so nice to hear this story, and we can relate to, you know, what the Mets truly does for the people who to see it through, right? To put yourself out there. You know, I think jiu-jitsu has a way to include people in different ways. Sometimes people can't find, they can't find themselves anywhere else, but the mentality of inclusion, which is something like, if you think about, you know, somebody who burned their house, comes to the school, you know, everybody expect their kid to be trouble, but that was not even a hesitation. That was actually an open door. And through being included, he saw himself, you know, in a different light. And I think that we can probably feel that way. That many of us probably, you know, would never be training today if that wouldn't be an open door for each one of us. And that links a lot to the mentality of that we have in Gracie Barra to continuously develop. Right, and development is a very big word, in my opinion, because it expands in everything. Development, it is about the journey of a student through jiu-jitsu, right? You can develop technically, you develop as a person inside the mats, but also inside of the school, that also different kinds of development. There are people who want to see jiu-jitsu further. They wanted to become a staff member. They want to coach. They want to instruct. Eventually, those people become professors. And eventually, those people become school owners. And this is constant mentality of grow and develop, right? But this is, for me, what shows who truly we are as a team. We are constantly pushing ourselves to give back to the community, because we know the benefit that happened to us, and we feel like it's a mission to help people through it. And now what I feel today is so different is because we know by fact, by history, by the timeline, looking as a global view of the benefits of jiu-jitsu and what jiu-jitsu is bringing to people's life. Now we're living at 36 years of the results of the environment of jiu-jitsu. Of the environment of the mats. And we have also evolved as leaders, practitioners, because we realize the bigger impact that it makes to people's life, that made us change the way we approach jiu-jitsu. Because from some of the things I said earlier, we are not very inclusive always, because mentorship was missing. And then through the development of leadership and able to find the right people within the organization that put a light into those things and help us develop something greater. And that's what I believe we are living today, an environment that people are included, right? Doesn't matter who you are, and jiu-jitsu for everyone is this viewpoint of developing and including. I remember very early how training jiu-jitsu was so for a few that in the school that I came from, my teacher denied the access of women to train. That was an open spoken statement. At that time, I was too young to appreciate, understand how terrible this really is, because you just are in that environment. That was like 1996 mentality.
It was partially because his wife was really jealous and it was hard for him to feel that, you know, the teacher. But then, not going back in details, but it was the environment that didn't include women. And what we have been going through now, generations and generations of evolution, today we have jiu-jitsu for everyone, including so many people, not just women, but like kids, tiny champions, all the way to the seniors.
Back in the day, we didn't even have like kids class. I remember when I started, it was like doing the adults already. I was like 13.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't have kids like my age, and I had to train with the adults and stuff. People much older, heavier, right?
You know, whenever you talk about teaching kids, most people at that time go, oh, not too much work, or too difficult, right? And that's to see how, you know, the mentality that was nurtured through the evolution of time, and also jiu-jitsu's been following, and Gracie Barra has been leading the movement to prove that it doesn't matter, you know, who you are, you are welcome in the school. And today, we can see jiu-jitsu has been an incredible thing for many women, for many kids, for many senior, I know, over 60s are training jiu-jitsu. My dad, he started to train jiu-jitsu at the age of 64. So that's not, wouldn't be possible before. And I think this is a lot to celebrate, because that was from that mentality of inclusion that Master Carlos always had, that it was not at that time developed or shared because communication was difficult and we didn't have systems like ICP, like courses, education for the people across the world. And that process was developing in different timelines, at different speeds all over the world. But for the last 10 years, we closed that gap in a very powerful way. And then today we see a beautiful reality, what jiu-jitsu really is at the moment. But I think that we're just scratching the surface. And I think we're just beginning a new movement of the generations of leaders that are, and representatives like such as for the female Vanessa, Professor Vanessa, Professor Vivi that's here, and many others that are coming, supporting, and many schools that focus on kids. They have great, like Professor Graeme Finneran, the great kids program, you know, developing and sharing jiu-jitsu with kids that now becoming adults and the adults becoming the new generation. And I think through that timeline, we will be seeing a much bigger impact in the last 10, 20 years, which is pretty incredible. But enough talking about serious stuff, and let's think about something a little different. You know, some of the experience of Master Carlos that we all may had, what was the most embarrassing one?
The most embarrassing.
Have a think about the embarrassing experiences that we can just have a laugh about.
Because anything that comes to mind. Vai.
You know, the reason why we're bringing this light. Like the reason why I'm bringing this light is because many of you guys probably never get the chance to meet Master Carlos yet. We are working on eventually making that happen at some point, but probably you can see the photo on the picture on the wall of the academy, and you probably create that picture in your head. And everybody, when they come to the United States with me, and he gets to meet or she gets to meet Master Carlos, they get shocked. I didn't expect him to be that way. You know, because he's a really interesting character. You know, he's funny. He says like funny jokes, and he makes really himself.
A lot of metaphors that is up to the metaphor that he uses, whatever he just experienced like a couple hours ago. He explains anything through his metaphors. Right?
Yeah, it's really funny. So that's why I brought the question to kind of put a light in a different way of Master Carlos. You know, I thought, maybe we can start over here some of the guys who spend a lot more time with Master Carlos. I can bring some.
What you can start. I know you have some.
No. Tem uma leve?
Yeah, I remember like when we were all young and, you know, some of us on Friday we want to do something in Rio de Janeiro and going out, and Carlinhos didn't appreciate that much. He wants us ready for training on Monday. But some of us really like to go out, and eventually when we come on Monday, he asks, so, how was on the weekend? And somebody comment, and everybody more quiet about it. And it was a classic, he would say, what, you're planning to be a DJ? Or, you know, like, he was always asking, like, what, you have any project to be a DJ? Because for his logic was like, if you're spending time with this, you're probably planning to work in the... So you want to be a DJ. So he had this approach of like, what are you doing there, you know?
You know, I have one as well. All right, can I get it back?
Yes,
I have one,
definitely.
So I can start a little bit. So that was, I was coming to the World Championships in 2003. And then I remember, because at that time, to compete at Gracie Barra, you needed to be like selected, like to be Team A. It still happens the same on a very different scale. But it was very clear those conversations because the team was so small. So whoever had the best for Gracie Barra would be selected, would be chosen to be with the Team A. So you represent Gracie Barra. So then I was a juvenile, no, I think maybe adult, my first year of adult. And I was coming over to compete, and I was feeling really in good shape, but I never knew where I would stand. I just want to compete, I didn't care where, but I want to represent the team, but I didn't know, I didn't care. But then somehow, there were other athletes around that was a little bit upset because Marcia Carlos picked me and another blue belt to represent Team A. And then there was, I'm not gonna say names, but like three of them. They were all teenagers from Barra da Tijuca, but they wanted to be actors, right? Actors in Malhação, which is a soap opera for like, it's like a prime time for teenagers, like it's like a soap opera, is it? Yeah, kind of soap opera, isn't it? Yeah. TV show, it's a TV show, it's still on until today. And then this guy was coming to Marcia Carlos, so Marcia Carlos, but why am I not going to be Team A? You know, he had actually Gracie in his name. And he wanted to be Team A because he felt like he's a family man, a family name, he wanted to be there. And he came over, oh, because he speaks like with this funny voice. Hey. Have you trained with that kid over there? Have you trained with that kid over there? Yeah? But they're really, really looking tough now. You wanna be going to the TV show? Do you wanna be an actor or do you wanna be a fighter? Actor or fighter? But you are a fighter, but you come with this conversation about being an actor, but you're gonna stay there. You're gonna be fighting where you are. Like, that was like a character. It's, I tried to make the sound of his voice a little bit because I think everybody relates to what he says. But the way he says that. Você quer ter lutador ou ator? Ator. Porra de ator. That was funny. That was like, the thing is, I was listening to that from under the stairs, and he was having the conversation on the staircase going to the mats. So I was listening from the bottom, but I didn't know what to say. Oh, that was pretty funny for me because I could see him as he would be normal, no, without me being there. That's one of the funny experiences that I had.
Even though it's funny, but the message is giving him passing on a message for the person. You know,
it's real.
It's reality.
And it's authentic, and that's what makes it so special.
Yeah.
So we all know Roger Gracie, right?
Everybody does.
Roger was not, you know, the GOAT that we know him to be for now, nowadays, when he was a white belt or a blue belt. That really started to show when he became a purple belt. So I think the question you asked, Victor, was like, what was one of the most embarrassing moments that I witnessed with him? A lot of it was just like how hard and real he was with the people he loved and cared about. And Roger was definitely one of them. They had a great connection from the beginning, we could tell. There was actually some people that were even jealous about it, but Roger was talented, great, always very coachable. But he walked into an environment that was a very, very tough one. And the reason why it was tough to train at Barra, it's because there is two things going on at the same time, okay? First was the most playboyish neighborhood you grew up with, right? Like, what happened around the school, it was like the perfect playboy lifestyle. Upper middle class, everybody's going out, and, you know, a beach town, surfing, right? So, and you had this influence of people who are supposed to be fighters and they want to be actors, right? You had this thing going on there and many other things. And Roger, of course, was influenced by it. We were all. But, you know, and you have to train at what was arguably in the 90s, in the early 2000s, the toughest jiu-jitsu school for you to be in, the toughest jiu-jitsu mats for you to be in. And I remember Hodger coming up, and there was a lot of expectation because he was always a big kid, and Master Carlos would spend a lot of time with him on the side, but Hodger wasn't really keeping up with him, right? And his the way for him to light you up, meaning like to go hard on you, you were like, you either break or you make it, you know? And I remember one day Hodger was training with his older cousin, Hoylish, and man, Hodger was not doing good on that training. And then it was right after, like, he had like a little private session with Master Carlos. Man, when he came out, man, I don't know why the building did not collapse, because it was like, look at you, son. You have my blood. You have the blood of the Gracie family, and you train like a chicken. It's unbelievable. What the heck is wrong with you, man? For you to be good in jiu-jitsu, you have to be born again and again and again. And if you're lucky, maybe you're going to be a little bit good. That was Roger Gracie as a blue belt. Man, that kid survived. And that's why he became the gold, man. That was one of the most embarrassing ones. I don't know if you were there that day, but it was a rough one.
I know. This is kind of common, this kind of approach, like the hand on.
Oh dear.
If you do something wrong, my God. And then, you know.
Oh man.
Yeah, but you know, now something interesting that was not directly related to Master Carlos, but with one of the higher belts there, an experience that I had, and I was thinking about this today, actually talking about it, and how important was for me at that point to face that situation. And I think it's interesting to bring this up as we're remembering stories. Yeah, so when I got my blue belt and I was training a lot in the morning, in the evening. At that time, that was not so common, two trainings per day. But because we were so passionate, we come in the morning, go back home, eat, rest, go back to train. So it gave us the edge. And as a blue belt and a very light person, I was a warm-up for most of my idols. We didn't have warm-up in the gym, so usually it was like, Maia, come, first round. So I was the first round of all the legends that I look up. And with this type of environment, I had no other direction than having good results. And as a blue belt and 18 years old, good results turned me into a monster. Into a monster in the negative way. So I walk like a peacock. I became the big, you know? I had the feeling that there was more because I was winning. I was a blue belt training with black belts. Somehow I started to feel more special than I was. And as a blue belt, I one day was walking the gym, but like I do every day, for me it was already my way. And when I entered the gym, one guy, brown belt, a champion, that he had much more results than me, he said, sit here, can I talk with you a little bit? I said, yeah, so tell me. And I said, what's wrong with you? Do you think you are a superstar or something? And I look at him and I play stupid, of course. What, me? He said, yeah, I'm talking with you. What's wrong with you? I said, but I don't understand you. I come to train every day. Look how you're walking around. What you think? I will kick you. if I have to. Do you know that? And I was like, but why? So because that's it. Do you have anything against that? I said, of course not. And I was so upset with that person that I, at some point, he was out of my list of idols. And I was like, man, I cannot be treated like this. You know, how the guy approached me, you know, and tell me these things and say, if you don't go down, I will beat you. You know, and I was like, but I didn't do nothing to him. But he just took over and said this to my face. He couldn't do better for me, you know, because at that moment, it was the best thing I could listen at that age, at that moment of my life. Eventually, we see this happening with students and we don't do nothing. And in the black belt, it would be much harder to talk about it. You understand? So I'm lucky that in the blue belt, I had someone to say, calm down, okay, calm down. But in a bit hard way, let's say. But it was so important. And now I'm talking about the Gracie Barra environment in the 90s and how we grew up and how people educate us. It was on a tough way. It was like he was looking me in the eyes and telling me seriously that if I would not calm down, he would take actions, you know? And nobody told him to do that. He just felt in position to put me on my place. And at that point, I realized that was not enough to be good. You have to be good and humble and act in a certain way. And sometimes I see that we as instructors, we see this happening in front of us. Because who don't get confident when you start learning some jiu-jitsu? And if you start winning, and if nobody come and say, hey, calm down, you know, because like you said before, we're gonna have a peak and we're gonna go down. We're gonna learn that you will not be all the way up forever. And at some point you're gonna start to go down. And so it doesn't matter in which moment of life you are, if we understand that even if we are doing good on the mats, we're not standing out. And I think Gracie Barra made a big step with the uniforms that maybe we don't see as a big thing. Maybe the new students don't realize, but before we all have our own gis and things that make us in a way stand out for different reasons than being a good person. Standing out through your values, through your principles, through who you are, not because you are better or you jump higher or because you're more athletic or your kimono looks better, right? So I think that these lessons I learned in Gracie Barra naturally, sometimes in a hard way, but we were always taught by the higher belts that keep calm, it's all good, you know, we're all here. And I think all these things that came out in the last 10 years, they were all driving us in this direction. You know, I had this feeling that all the movements that Gracie Barra is doing are in this direction, right? That we can progress, keeping progressing, but not acting in a wrong way, I would say, you know, like keeping our feet on the ground and, you know, even if we are trying to get better and have results, you know? So that's what I want to share, because sometimes as instructors, as I said, you see this, you know? And I think we can have different ways to say that, but we have to take actions. We don't have to use the method that I have to face in Rio de Janeiro 90s, but I think we could figure out a way to, once recognizing it, that we can call and, you know, and have this conversation, you know what I mean? Because you're a white belt, you don't know anything. After 1 year, you know you can handle a person. And now you are different, and this is confidence. But where this line goes? Where's this line of confidence goes if we don't stop it? If we just feel like confidence, and this goes beyond. So I think when we understand that this confidence can make us do things with excellence, because I think this is the point, we can have excellence in all aspects. And then I think this is the line that I think that we should, okay, here's a good line to stand. That my confidence go to here and not beyond that. And I was lucky that at 18 I had this call, you know, like, listen, calm down, you know? So I think that is something I would like to share with you. Was a tough experience, not so embarrassing because was on a side. He called me on the side, was more scary than embarrassed. But you know, but yeah, it was something that I experienced at that time. And I think we are in a different moment, but we still have to see these things in a way. We still have to recognize these things and act on it.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Professor. Can I? Nice. I have something to share.
Oh my God! God.
Anybody wants to get a drink? Go and do it now, really quickly.
What a break!
What a break!
What a break!